Welcome, everybody. Buonasera, benvenuti. I'm delighted at the turnout because I really didn't know what to expect after I saw Deborah Parker's article and wrote to her and said, let's do something. She said, sure, do something. Soon after the new year, she said, sure. And we started talking. And I really wasn't sure who was going to respond and how people were going to respond and so on and so forth. The response was excellent. There were actually a couple of more people who would have wanted to be part of it. But at that point, we had already had a template, a platform, and everything was full. So I'm delighted that the other thing I wanted to say is, as some of you still may not know, Italian Americans are a protected class within the City University of New York. And it is a unique classification for Italian Americans. However, if you are at all conversant with the history of Italians in the United States, especially the great wave of immigration, it's not really that odd of a classification. There's a lot more to say about that, and we do that in our sort of regular programming here at the Calandra Institute. And I think most of that, the experience of what brought to that point of Italian Americans being a protected class is really, in some ways, germane to about three or four major cities in the United States, New York, of course, being one, and then some other major cities around the country, one, of course, in which the neighborhood was literally razed to put the University of Illinois, as some of us know. So, but I'm delighted that we have the representative of the City University of New York. That is, we have Interim Chancellor Vida Carulli Rabinowitz with us, who's going to make some opening comments. Vida's as long as I've been here, a longtime friend of the Institute. She has been extremely supportive of the Institute and also extremely supportive of some of the initiatives that we have moving forward, and has made it and has actually said in writing that she supported initiatives. So that's something that, as some of you know, college, and now you're going to say it on television, college administrators tend to be rather vague, don't we? So without further ado, I want to invite Vida up and say a few words.
Thank you, Anthony, for your kind words. And colleagues, even though I must leave to go to a memorial service right after this part of the panel, I want to tell you that I am truly delighted to be here. As a proud Italian-American who did grow up in different times, as many of us who are Italian-American did, I understand and appreciate what the City University of New York has done in creating the Calandra Institute, which is now widely recognized as the greatest scholarly center for Italian-American studies in this country. I'm particularly proud to be here to welcome you to a provocative topic by a provocative author. I've read Dr. Parker's essay on race and ethnic issues in Italian studies, and was moved by her personal story as well as some of the data that or lack of data that she points to about diversity in foreign language study, generally Italian in particular. A little bit about CUNY for those of you who don't know it. CUNY is arguably the most diverse institution of higher learning in the United States, if not the world, and in all the ways that matter. Ethnic background. We have at CUNY 23,000 Dominican students. That's the size of a large CUNY college. We are diverse with respect to country of origin. Our students are born in 100 different countries throughout the world. Language spoken at home. Social class, gender identity of its students. 76% of our undergraduate students are people of color, and about slightly over one-third of our faculty are from underrepresented groups. 40% of our students speak a language other than English at home. I could fill my allotted time with talk only of CUNY's diversity and our pride in this, but I want you to know that you are speaking at one of the most diverse universities in the world, where we are not simply diverse, but I like to think we are also inclusive and equitable in how we treat our students, our faculty, and our staff. We strive to be. We're hardly perfect. The John D. Calandra Institute of Italian American Studies is a particular source of pride, not just for me, an Italian American interim chancellor, but because it is one of the finest academic centers dedicated to the study of the history, culture, socioeconomic life of Italian Americans Italians outside of Italy, particularly in New York, particularly in the United States, but the Italian diaspora, which is vast all over the world. As it happens at this moment, New York State's governor, just reelected to a third term, New York City's mayor, recently elected to a second term, and the interim chancellor and the interim executive vice chancellor for academic affairs are all Italian Americans. That's a moment in time, I assure you, but it's still all right. It's gratifying to see, by the way, the diversity in this room and the standing room only crowd, because I think diversity in foreign language study, diversity in cultural studies will be very important to its vibrancy in the future. I speak here as an interim chancellor and former university provost. I read in Professor Parker's provocative essay, Race and Foreign Language, that we lack good data on diversity within foreign language programs at a time when our world is increasingly globalized, diverse, and data-driven. As a social scientist, I know that it's hard to make progress in any domain when you don't know where you're starting from, when you don't have a baseline. I know that there is a scholarly volume coming out of this conference, and one of the things I hope it spawns, if not in this group, in others who care about these things, and they are legion throughout CUNY, how we might begin to conceptualize and measure diversity in foreign language study at CUNY. I think it's important. It's important that New York's great public university, New York City's only great public university, have vibrant foreign language study and have vibrant cultural study. So I think we should lead in defining the state of our disciplines and our fields and use those data to make changes. The next conference, and Anthony, I will come no matter where I am, might be on the social science of foreign language study, with a particular emphasis on Italian, of course. I want to say, and Italian-American studies. But I do hope that this core of dedicated scholars will make the concerted effort to get them to get those data. The challenges are many, but as I looked over the program for today, I was delighted to see emerging trends. Just from reading your abstract, colleagues, I learned about, you know, special relationships between Italy and China, and of which I was not aware. I am a provost at heart, as I said, on leave from my position as university provost, where faculty, academic programs, curricula, and pedagogy were very much in my purview. I know from experience how hard it is to start new academic programs in the current fiscal climate, which is why I believe that collaboration, cross-cultural, cross-disciplinary collaboration, is going to be important to the future and I care about the future. I am rooting for you. I am concerned not simply about foreign language study, but about the arts and humanities. Which, you know, many of you know, enrollments in those areas have been declining. So what can we do to revitalize those areas, attract students, hire wonderful faculty? Well, one thing we could do is, again, have provocative conversations like the one that Professor Parker started. As I went through the program, I saw, I'll notice just a few general themes. I'm not an expert in your area, and I won't attempt to say very much about it. But I was taken with, again, frank conversations about race and ethnicity and how one feels in a discipline where most of the people don't look like you, don't sound like you. I think those were incredibly revealing and poignant and instructive. But I also saw much mention of curricular and pedagogical innovation, which I think is important. At CUNY, where most of our students come to us without a lot of advantages, we have learned that rich experiential learning, many of our students can't afford to study abroad, but what they can afford to do and what we want to expand is service abroad. When our students are helping people within and beyond the United States, but I've seen it, I've certainly seen it in Puerto Rico. CUNY Service Corps went to Puerto Rico to help rebuild after Hurricane Maria. And our students found themselves. They spent all day building, repairing homes. They didn't want to come home. So it's engaging, it's applied learning. It's connecting with what you love and what you're good at. It's taking yourself out of the classroom. It's what goes on outside of the classroom as much as inside. Anyway, I thought many of your curricular innovations were smart and fruitful and could bring in new generations of learners. I also thought your challenges to canonical notions of literature, curricular change, is very important. And I, you know, encourage you to go on there. As Anthony alluded to, and Anthony, I will say it again, I think there are exciting ideas for advanced study, master's and doctoral level study in working with colleagues in cognate areas to make change. I have also been advised that Italy's current field of writers of color, including, and I will mangle these names, I don't speak Italian, and these names are not all Italian or Italian at all, but Pop Kuma, Igiaba Shego, and Amara Lacus, to name a few, are gaining strength in Italy. This is a new trend here, but of course with the migration that Italy has experienced over the last several years, Italy is a changing country, right? That these writers give us hope for a dynamic future with space for creative studies. I confess that I am reading only Italian in translation these days, but the works of Alana Ferrante and Domenico Stornone have just captured my heart, and I'm working through all of them. But I am excited that there are that the field of literature, always so strong in Italy and among Italian Americans, is so vibrant. I was also pleased to see presentations on the LGBTQAI+ spectrum, because that's an area we don't talk about enough throughout the curricula. So colleagues, in closing, just a couple of things. Our world is changing at a rate never seen before, becoming ever more globally oriented, technologically advanced. As you gather here this evening and tomorrow, as you form your presentations for the volume that will appear and have its mark, I hope you consider how the forces of globalization and advanced technology could extend your reach. Because again, your work is exceptional. I know the quality of work that appears here, and I want the world to know it, and I, you know, again, my heart is with you in your work. So, while I must leave now, I want to thank Dean Tambori for all he does to keep the Calandra Institute, the superb institute for higher learning that we know it to be, and it was my honor to be here.
It's my pleasure now to call to the podium Dr. William Bill McClure. Bill is the Dean of the Division of Arts and Arts and Humanities at Queens College. Every college within the City University of New York has their own names for division. Division of Arts and Humanities. But for the last year or so, he's been hanging out in the provost's office as interim provost. But we're happy that he's coming back to the Division of Arts and Humanities down in Queens Hall. So, Bill.
Thank you very much for having me. My official role is to bring greetings and apologies from both my president, Felix Matos Rodriguez, and Elizabeth Hendry, our provost, who were both unable to be here this evening, so I apologize that you only get me. But they do send greetings and they do send apologies that they can't be here. I have to say that I'm actually very happy to be here. What Anthony didn't say, so it is true I'm the Dean of Arts and Humanities at Queens College. What he didn't tell you was that I'm professor of Japanese. And when I learned about this program and I read Professor, you know, Parker's article and I read the various sorts of things to prepare for this evening, this is really one of the few times in my entire career that I've introduced a conference that I actually thought I would like to stay for the entire conference and learn something about it. And I am sorry that I won't be able to stay for more of it. And I say this because I actually have a sort of a similar sort of story. I am half Japanese. My name is William McClure, and I teach Japanese, but I did not learn Japanese from my mother. I learned it by studying. And so I've navigated a lot of these things that involve not looking the right way and speaking the language and teaching it and these kinds of things. And so that's made me very aware of the kinds of issues that I hope you will be addressing this evening and tomorrow. That's why this is such an interesting sort of topic that I would like to learn more about. The other reason I would like to learn about it actually is that in my field of Japanese language and linguistics, no one talks about this kind of thing. Okay, this is, you know, Japan is a very, to say that Japan is a homogeneous society is really an understatement. But, you know, Japanese instruction in the United States, obviously there is diversity. Obviously we're teaching a whole range of students. And so the questions are always, how do you teach things correctly so that this range of students, when they go to Japan, can succeed? And one of the basic issues, of course, for students is that when everyone in this room, except sort of ironically, Professor Park, will look wrong in Japan, okay, and people will notice you as you walk down the street, and you will never be able to escape that. And so and it's not an aggressive thing, it's just a fact of life. So one of the things that it's important to teach students is how do you navigate that? You know, what does that mean for your own, the way you live, the way you work, the way you interact with people, this kind of thing, these kinds of questions. And it's interesting from my experience because I think that instructors who are actually not Japanese are better at explaining this because they've experienced it. And so I'm always very interested in the issue of listening to the way instructors talk about, you know, a culture. Italy, Japan, whatever it is like that. Are they explaining it in the terms that their students will understand and the diversity of their students to the degree that they will understand it? Or are they talking about it in the terms that they understand? So the flip side of this is, of course, in Japan, everybody studies English from the junior high school, and that's all very interesting because the Japanese end up speaking a dialect of English which is understood basically only in Japan. English is taught not very well in Japan. But I remember this very specifically because I was listening to an instructor tell their students that the S that we use for third person, you know, John runs, that kind of thing, is an honorific marker in English. Okay, they and what they said was that in the English-speaking world, people express respect to people they're talking about. Okay, now this makes perfect sense to Japanese because this is exactly what they do in Japanese. They make their language, they grammaticize honor, and so that means if I respect you, I will use one verb form, and if you're my friend, I will use another verb form. It's a system, and it can depend on how well we know each other. So it's a system that takes sort of the tu vu of French or that sort of thing, and then crosses with it social relationships. Okay, so if you're important and you're my friend, I speak to you one way. But if you're important and I don't know you, I speak to you a completely different way. And so this is a pretty complex system, but the explanation, though, that the third person S in English is an honorific, makes perfect sense to Japanese students. And this worked quite successfully, and I just thought it was the craziest thing I'd ever heard. But this is a very small thing, but it's what I mean. You know, are you providing an explanation that makes sense to the world, to your students, you know, and the world that they live in? Or are you talking about things in ways that make sense to you, you know, as a native speaker or as an adult or whatever it is like that? So for me, my whole life, my whole professional career really has been about sort of asking and answering these kinds of questions to make instruction, sort of make an understanding of what is truly foreign as successful as possible. I mean, that's always the difficult part is when you talk about a foreign society, it's truly foreign. It's not been, you know, it's not what we see on television. It's not all these, you know, it's not all the things we believe. It's a truly very different kind of experience, which is interesting, but which is also scary. The other experience that I had that I remember to this day is when I was in Japan and I was a graduate student, I think, I had a friend who was African American. And what he said to me was, welcome to what it's like to being black in the United States. Okay, because in Japan, you always stand out. He actually said it was better in Japan because the Japanese weren't afraid. They weren't disrespectful. They just noticed. Okay, and so it was for me this was very interesting. I mean, I know that everyone has had these kinds of experiences, and so I'm very interested in everything that you're doing because I think it's so important and it's so interesting to have it sort of talked about formally, and then written down, and so it's possible to discuss things and agree and disagree and whatever. Because up to now, certainly in my field, it's just anecdotal. People talk about this kind of thing all the time, but there's no strategy, there's no best practices, there's none of these kinds of things. So, what I intend to do personally is actually, after the volume for this conference is published, is I would like to take it and introduce it to my field. Because I think that this would be very important and very significant in Japanese in particular, but other areas where I also happen to work. So again, that's all I have to say. I really am happy to be here, and I'm really looking forward to what I can hear this evening, and thank you very much.
You're going to find a survey, for example, in your packet that we did. We just did a survey a couple of years ago. We threw out a survey about graduate studies, graduate programs. I think there are something like 48. We identified 48 graduate programs. 30 responded, but we sent it out to everybody who was part of any graduate program. And so we sent that out to a few hundred people, and you can get more information from either Nick Grosso or Lisa Cicchetti, who are the two people who then took that information and compiled it in that nice little package that you have in the folder. And that speaks a little bit to a few things about this meeting that we're having, and you'll see. I also need to thank Joseph Shore, Sean Gibby, and Rosangela Brichese, who are always around and ready and willing to offer when I write and say, write from home in the morning and say, please send out a message in the next 2 hours on Constant Contact, that we are, for example, live streaming this on Facebook as Sean did today. So I'm extremely grateful to them and to the other members of the staff whom I haven't mentioned, but who are here and help this machine run very well. It's not a one-person show. It's a multi-person show. the data, we will work on this as we wait for your essays. We'll figure out something about gathering data. We have people here who are very conversant with data, getting, grabbing data, and also crunching it. Carmine Pizzirusso, in fact, is one of them. So he's being put on. But now being told that we're going to work on that, Carmine. So we'll look into that. There's a person, I think this is so uncanny. There's a person missing today who couldn't come because she couldn't get a visa. And I just think that an Italian American Institute that deals with immigration, migration, the history of migration of one group that is has a symposium on diversity and migration is indeed part of some of your papers, that this person unfortunately is not with us. So it speaks to sort of even more the necessity. I want to give you another anecdote. I had written to an old friend and colleague of mine and never got an answer. And I was asking him a favor, never got an answer. And I thought, this is not like so-and-so. So-and-so usually answers whatever. And today I got an email from him that said, gee, you know, after we met at such and such and you didn't answer, I thought, blah, 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 what's going on? And I don't know if he's watching. I'm not going to identify him out of courtesy, not to identify. And then he realized that my email, which had finally popped up this morning, had been blocked and sent to spam because it had two words in it. One was fascism and the other was resistance. And he worked it out with his techies now so that my email will now go to him. So I thought that was, again, I thought that it happened on this day was sort of interesting. We don't talk about these things. We have never spoken about these things in Italian studies. The only thing we've spoken about with regard to difference, quote unquote, or with regard to prejudices, and some people said racism, is the North-South question, which has seemed to have disappeared for a while, but now it seems to have come back again. And I think that's a good thing. But we never talk about these other things. And even though Italy has gone through 30 to 40 years of immigration to Italy, that Italy has been transformed sort of to some degree from a point of departure, people are still leaving, we know, to a point of arrival, we still don't talk about these things. And I think you'll find it very curious when you read some of the, we asked certain questions in the survey, you'll find the curious, the responses, and how most things are under 48 or 45%. But I just wanted to, I'm of that generation that did doctoral studies in the 70s, finished in the early 80s, and have been teaching in, at the college level more or less since 1980. And I just want to make a couple of points through anecdotes, and then we're running a little bit late, but there's nobody here to push us out. All of my undergraduate professors were Italian, either born and educated in Italy or from educated here, came here as young kids and then educated in the American school system. They were really, when you think about it, the fuga dei cervelli ante litteram, right? That we didn't call them that, but that's what they were. they would, I always found it comical, and we used to tease them when we felt we could, that they would insist on perfect Italian grammar and pronunciation. Yet, their English was wanting to be nicely, right? To be nice. I did my MA at Middlebury's Scuola Estiva Italiana, it was called back then, where all the professors were Italian-born, bred, raised, and half of them were invited, actually, from Italy for the summer. There were no professors who were born in the U.S. as part of the faculty when I was there, and perhaps the couple of years surrounding it. I was invited to teach there in 1978. And the only reason why that happened was because there was a new director. And the director knew one of my professors. And I was then invited to teach there. So I think I was sort of the first American-born person to have taught there. I always thought that was curious. When I did my PhD at Berkeley, we had basically all Italians, a couple of Italian-Americans. We had one American, Louise George Club, who was more in comp lit than she was in Italian, although she made her presence felt in Italian. And we had an Israeli, Gabriel Moses, who had gone to high school. Actually, he may have gone more years than that in Italy. And his Italian was eloquently native with a Ligurian accent because he went to school in Genova, right? But we didn't even speak about Italian Americans. And we were in Berkeley. We were in Berkeley, which, you know, was a 20-minute ride to Broadway and Columbus Avenue in San Francisco, where there was a slew of Italians, where there's the famous North Beach and things of that sort. I wanted, and speaking of diversity, I had about four or five titles, possible topics for a dissertation. I thought about D'Annunzio, I thought about Pavese, I thought about Pasolini, I thought about Penna, Sandro Penna, and I thought about Palazzeschi. There was this sort of P there going through, except for D'Annunzio, right? And for various reasons, whatever. I was really thinking about, because I did then and still appreciate poetry as a literary act, something to study. And I was really thinking about Sandro Penna, because he was really he was being discovered. He was still alive. He was being discovered. And I thought Penna could be, and there wasn't much on him, so I thought Penna could be a really good topic. D'Annunzio, of course, was a valid topic for my professors. Pavese was a valid topic for my professors. And remember, he was rediscovered in 68 by the Sessantottini and things of that sort. Pasolini, he had just been killed. So I don't know. He wasn't dead long enough, you know? And those of you who are Italian professors know what I'm talking about. Penna, forget about it. Penna was alive, first of all. And second, as one of my professors said, dopotutto è un poetuccolo omosessuale. And I said, well, what does that mean? He said, well, he's still alive, you know, and so is. So then I thought, well, there's Aldo Palazzeschi. Palazzeschi made it because even though he had died only a couple of years before, my decision to write on Palazzeschi coincided with a mega conference in 1976 at the University of Florence to which Palazzeschi had left his. Palazzeschi was basically a rich little boy. He lived off of his family wealth and he left basically everything to the University of Florence. And because there was that conference with a major publication by all the sort of big shots in Italian literary criticism at that time, Palazzeschi was a valid topic to study. And so I studied Palazzeschi, right? So these were some of the challenges that that some of us went through at a certain time in Italian studies. There are maybe two or three of you that more or less were of that same generation of PhDs. So you can understand a little bit more what I'm talking about. The idea of dealing with Italian American culture was an unspoken topic, the idea of Italian American literature. And the idea of something which is new here to some degree, and that is the writing in Italian outside of Italy, that wasn't even a concept, as we say in Italian, that entered the antechambers of your mind. That just didn't happen, talking about Italian writing outside of Italy. And if it did happen, it was those old immigrants at the beginning of the century who now have disappeared, and even their books, whatever, if we find them, we find them. If we don't find them, it's no big deal. So those are some of the challenges that we went through, those who were of my generation and are still around. The only female artist that I remember was Aleramo. The ideas of speaking about an Antonio Pozzi or Rosselli, Amelia Rosselli, even though they were long gone, you know, even though they were published by Mondadori in those really old, popular and sort of the best series, the beginning of Lo Specchio, that series that Mondadori, which they published all those great poets. They published also the great poets such as Amelia Rosselli and Antonio Pozzi, but they were never on reading lists. The only woman you saw was Sibilla Aleramo. And then maybe after La Storia, 1974, El Zamorante started to sneak in. You would find El Zamorante on a reading list. But otherwise, that was it. It was, you know, it ended in 68, basically. For those of us who were in the university programs in the 70s, the reading list ended at around 68, and that was it. Even someone as canonical as he was when he was alive, there was sort of a hit and miss, was Alberto Moravia. He was hit and miss. Because his novel was those that old enough, you could use L'Indifferenti. But otherwise, maybe you can use La Noia, and maybe you can use Agostino. But that was it. Anything more recent, no good, right? So today, I've noticed, even though I've spent more of my time in the last 12 years here and more in Italian-American studies, I still... I still make sure that I know what's going on in Italian studies. I still get all the journals and still go to the conferences occasionally when I can. It's much better, even though we can say it's not good in some cases, in some places. It's much better. And I'm hopeful that each and every one of you here will help make it better still for those who follow us, either for those who are much younger than us here or for those who follow us, because we just have to make sure that Italian studies doesn't continue to do now in the realm of diversity what it did back in the 70s in the realm of literary theory and criticism. There was none. There was no deconstruction. There was no reader response. There was no semiotics, even though there was Umberto Eco. There was none of that in most Italian studies programs. Now people are going to complain, and there'll be some comments on Facebook, et cetera, you know. But I would challenge people to show me where in the early 70s and the mid 70s there were courses on literary theory in Italian studies programs. I suspect we couldn't find any. Today we can, and that's great.